Alright, what's going on? Today we're going to be looking at a Pixel RGB filter for some textures on Blender. The main reason I'm making this is because I want to do like a retro TV effect, kind of like a CRTV with the scan lines and the little pixels and stuff. So we're going to try and replicate that effect today. I saw a paid shader, which is going to be in the link in the description, that does basically what we're doing today. It's just that I didn't have the money to afford this. So if you can, go ahead and check that one out. But if not, we can go ahead and check out how to do this right now. So like I said, if you have the money to spare and you're willing to put money into this, go ahead and buy this guy's shader. It's going to be a lot better for you than just recreating mine or downloading mine. But I am broke, so I can't do that. So what I did is I used a couple of these videos, one by Lane Wallace, I think two by Lane Wallace, a video by The Observatory, and then, this one right here, and then a video by this guy. And this is how I made my screen. So this is the guy who introduced me to the Modulo node. And then this is going to be the pixel filter on this. And then on top of that, Lane Wallace kind of got me introduced to everything. So if you want to check out those videos, go ahead. The link is in the description. But we're going to be using the techniques made by those videos in order to recreate what we're doing today. So hopping into it, trying to just, explain what's going on with the shader. So we have a pixel density telling us how many pixels are going to be on the screen. By default, the one is going to be a 4x4 or 3x4, depending on the type of image you have. We have pixel width and height, so that just tells us we can edit these a little bit more to our liking. Even if we don't want uniform pixels, we can start to change them. The edge size is just telling us how big we want the pixels on our screen to be. So if we take this circular off, and we can make all of these really smooth towards the end, so that way it kind of gives us a sort of dull effect on it. It's kind of nice. Hue saturation values, those are just to play with the colors of your image. The RGB, cyan, magenta, yellow, that just inverts the colors, so that way, depending on what kind of pixels you want, you can get whatever you want. Circle or square, we can turn these into circular pixels. And then if we want, we can take those and turn those into ovals, kind of make a shape that's closer to what's an actual pixel in real life is displayed as. But then we also have this pixel values right here. And if you see, as I slide this over, we're going to take all the values that are in each pixel and we're going to sum it up into one value. And that's the way that real pixels work as well. So if we size this up, as you can see, there's still all these little jagged edges in there. But if we take this, boom, these are actual pixels. They're just giving us one value to try and show us the color underneath. And if we scale it up, you can see we can start to see those lines come back in, but these are not the image lines. These were made with our pixels. So that's just kind of showing you everything. Oh, also we have scan size and scan off and on. So size, this is just gonna give us that old CRTV effect. As you can see, we can change the size to whatever, kind of make it a little bit more realistic. But it just kind of adds to the old vintage look. And that's just showing us everything that we're doing with this shader. So next, let's hop in and see how it's actually being created. So we have that image texture at the beginning, and we take that and we also have a image texture that is displaying our pixels. So if we change this back down to a value of 1, turn this pixels off. So this factor is just going to tell us, hey, whether or not we want to see these colors right here for what they are, or if we want them to be summed up into pixels.
then we're going to take that and we're going to separate those colors into their own separate channels. So that way we can take each of those values, plug it up to a modulo node, and what that's going to do is give us three separate channels to use, and we take those values, plug them in there, and then we have an effect that looks like this. And you can see the RGB start to take place. So we're going to multiply that with a brick texture to try and separate and give us these own individual pixels and not just lines running across our screen. Then we're going to multiply that by a Voronoi texture, and that's going to let us give us those circles effects that we're looking for, because some pixels, you know, are ovals or circles, whatever. Then we're going to take that, multiply it with this magic texture to get us the color ramp, or the, not the color ramp. We're going to take this and we're going to multiply it with a magic texture, and that's going to give us a scan line through our composition. Then we're going to take the final image and then add a roughness map to it. So that way it's not going to add too much detail, but just to try and make it a little bit more vintage, we'll have some lines and scratches running throughout it. So that's everything that you're going to need to use to build this shader. Let's get into it. Alright, so the first thing you're going to want to do when you hop into Blender is you're going to want to add in a plane, and we're going to go ahead and keep this square because the GIF that I'm using with this is going to be square as well. We're just going to add some shading to it because all we're really going to be messing with, never mind, we'll delete that one. Just duplicate that for now. Okay, load in your image texture. I'm going to go ahead and be using a GIF, but just to show you that you don't need to be using one, we're not going to go ahead and animate it until the very end. Okay, so that loaded up right there. And if you wanted to use a GIF or a video, what you do is you just turn up the frames for how many are in the video. And as you can see, we can start to see it animate. I don't know exactly how many are, so we're going to keep it at one for now. And then I guess we'll just duplicate this right here. And the first thing we're going to want to do is we're going to make the pixel texture. So to do that, we're going to need these over here. We're going to use the same coordinates for both of them. But what we're going to do is separate the X, Y, and Z for this one. We'll start with the X. We're going to need some math nodes. Multiply. Then so multiply this by 1. So basically what this is doing, this is just telling us all the X values from 0 to 1, imagine that, or 0 to 2 meters. This is telling us every value in between that. This is not actual color data. So what we're going to do is take those values, multiply them by 1, and then add a floor and a ceiling to them. So that way they get clamped at the highest value they could be and the lowest value they could be, which is kind of confusing. But so, as you can see, this is white or black. If we multiply this to 3, you can see this could be black and this could be like a third white, or this could be you know, a third dark, or this could be 100% white. You know, this is just telling us what we want it to do. Now we're going to add those two values together. Turn off that clamp. And then after we do that, we'll divide by 2. So that way we get the average of those two values. So there we go, something like that. Then we'll plug those values in for the vector. Then hopefully it should look something like this. I think we also have to divide by this value right here, this 3. So divide by 3, There we go. This is a little bit, makes a little bit more sense. Let's see what happens when we do this for the Y. If we can see a little bit more going on. Oh, and then combine X, Y, Z. Okay, so then if we want to, we want to have this 3 be the same value across the board. So to do that, we're going to take a value input, plug in 3, and just plug it up to all of these. Okay, then if we multiply this up, you can see we're starting to see our image texture from before. Sweet. So you can take some time to clean this up. That's what I'm gonna do right now. And then we'll carry on to doing the RGB now. All right, so I just took a little bit of time cleaning all this up. And so if we wanna be able to change from our regular image texture to our pixelated image texture, we're gonna need a mix color. So just add that, and we're gonna keep it at mix. So that way, everything just, it'll go straight from one to the other. For most of the other nodes in this tutorial, we're gonna use multiply, but this will be one that we just want to switch back and forth. So as you can see, 0 is the normal image texture, and we can make it pixelated at our will. So we're gonna start to create a node group. So what, Control G, yeah. So that way we can adjust the amount of, what's it called, the pixels or not. And then we're also going to want to be able to adjust this value right here. So we want it to start at 3. So just to make this easy, what I'm gonna do is multiply and turn this to a 1/3. So basically it's doing the same exact thing, except for when our value is 1 on the shader side, in reality it's going to multiply 3 pixels on the thing. Which doesn't make a lot of sense, but, oh, not factor, value. Okay, so, see, at the value of 1, we'll have a 3/3 square, which is, that's the look I'm going for. If you just want it to be a 1 value, you can just take away this and then keep it at 1. Because, I mean, that is also how real life works. One pixel is divided up into 3 colors, RGB. But the way I want to do it, I want it to have 3/3. So we're going to do it like that. So now to start the RGB section, we're going to take these coordinates, duplicate it. We're going to add, separate X, Y, Z. And then we're going to use a bunch of math nodes again. But this time, the math node we're going to be worrying about is modulo. So take that, multiply it by 1. Then we're going to do modulo. And I'm not really too sure what that does, but I mean, looking at it right now, it seems like it's doing the same thing as last time. But we're going to add some color ramps to tell this modulo what to do. So we're gonna need 3 for each of the colors. So this first one is gonna be red. We're gonna set it to constant. And we only want the white values on the first third. So we'll take white, put it at 0, and then black, we'll turn it at 1/3. Then we'll, for this one, it's gonna be the green values in the middle. So in order to do that, keep the black at 0. We're gonna add a white, put it at 1/3. Then we're going to add another black at 2/3. Okay, and then this is going to be the last one. Should be pretty easy. Just put... I guess not. I didn't know what to do. Put white at 2/3, and then boom. Okay, so we have our simple RGB going on. Now, we need to be able to combine this color data. So set that right here. And what we're going to do is we're going to take the color data from the other one, and we're going to add it into this one. So as you can see, what we're going to do is we're going to put the modulo. Ooh, okay, that's what we didn't do. There we go. Bet. Okay, so we take this separate color, move it over here just for now. We're going to multiply these two. And so that way, we separated these colors into red, green, and blue. And so now, the red values will only show up where they need to be. So we'll plug in that right here. That right here. Do that for each of the colors. So now if we take a combined color and view that, we have different nodes set up. There's a little bit of artifacts popping up at the edges, as you can see, but it's working fairly well. Now if we multiply this density, you can see we have our RGB effect. But what we want to do is we want to be able to change the amount of pixels we have with the amount of pixels we're adding on the other shader. So to do that, we're going to have to multiply this one by the other one. So get a node group, put it over here, just plug in this value right here. So now, as we increase it, the pixels are increasing. And they aren't split up yet, but you can already see the RGB effect is taking place. And we can turn this factor off, so that way the image can still have all of its clarity or non-clarity. But I like having this pixel turned on, so that way it summarizes each of the values, and so it just kind of adds to that look and replicates what actually happens in real life. So we have the RGB set up, but we want to be able to separate them into their own individual pixels. And to do that, we're going to need a brick texture. So I'm going to go ahead and clean this up. Okay. Somewhere along the way, I messed up last time, so we're going to go ahead and redo this brick texture. So as you can see, we got the RGB effect going into place. But what we need to do is we need to separate these nodes or these lines into different nodes. And we'll do that with a brick texture. That's the easiest way I've found to do this so far. We're going to switch over to that. And as you can see, we're already starting to get the shape that we want. Turn both of the colors all the way up to white, so that way we get the actual color we want from this mask. Turn offset to 0 or 1, so they're all straight. And then what we need is we need a 3x3, because if you think about having this value at 1, we have a 3x3. Because if we think about this picture, we have a 3x3, and so we need to replicate that on here. So in order to do that, just turn down the scale. Seems like 1.5 seems to be the trick. Mortar size, we can leave that as it is. Brick height, we want this to be equal, so that way we have squares. Then now we basically have the mask for what we're doing. Let me put a control T. All right, still good. Make sure it's on generated. And so what we're going to do is we need to up this scale as we increase the scale over here. I'm not sure why this is not working. Oh, that's why. As we up this scale. So as we increase this scale, this one needs to go up. So at 1, this scale needs to be 1.5. So we're going to take a math node. We're just going to multiply the scale by 1.5. Then get a group input. Plug that in to the pixel density. So then we plug this in right here. And then what we're going to do is we're going to use this multiply to multiply the two images. So now you see we have a edge to each of our pixels. And if we go back out of here, we can multiply the amount of pixels we have on screen, which is pretty sick. We're going to want to get the edge size and the edge smoothness from this, just so that way we can increase the edge size if we want. And then we can also make these more smooth, so that way they give like this dulled out effect, which looks pretty cool. So I'm going to take those and plug that into edge size and edge smooth. Then for the brick height and width, we want to be able to adjust the value of these. So let's go back to 1. As you can see, the easiest way to do this is to think about what value you need to get double. So it's at 0.5 right now. If we go down to 0.25, you can see we have doubled the amount of bricks on the x-axis, and we can do that for the same thing on the y-axis. So we want to do that for both of these, and we want to do that when we adjust the width and the height. So in order to do that, we'll have to look at this value right here, the pixel density. We're going to try to adjust this. Well, no. We're going to take the pixel width and plug it in for the scale. So that way now we can adjust the scale when we're messing with the pixel width. But as you can see, if we go to 2, that's going to give us double the amount of the RGBs we need. This value needs to be divided as this value gets multiplied. So just change this, duplicate one, and change it to divide. And we'll put that into brick width for the pixel width. Move this shit around. Everything getting crowded right now. But then, okay, so then if we go back out here, if we change the width, we start to change the width on here. So, and we don't need anything to plug in for the height, because the height is its own value. You know, the color is going to stay the same all the way through the y-axis for the RGB at least. So then now we can multiply these and get whatever effect we want. So what if we wanted to do that while we had the pixels on? Because as you can see, we want to be able to control the amount of pixels on screen as we control the amount of width and height. And we're not doing that. We're just adding more pixels on there. So in order to do that, we're going to have to adjust the value that we're multiplying from. And so if we think about this, if this all is set to 1, we would only be displaying one color value up here, and that would be the summarized average color of the picture you're showing. So if we're increasing the pixel width and the height, we're telling it that we want to multiply whatever amount of pixels we have on here by this number, basically. So in order to do that, it's pretty easy. We just have to take this, and instead of multiplying these values by just 3, we're going to take this and multiply it by our pixel width and our pixel height. So that should be good. Yeah, that works. So what you want to do is you're going to want to take this one, and you can move this over here. But we're going to need 2 different values for the width and the height. So we're going to take this value, plug it into here. We're going to plug this into the width. Seems like I already got that going on. Okay, sorry for the confusion. Okay, cool. So basically, our first node multiplies by 3, and then we want this node to multiply by the width and the height. So now we have that going on. Then we need to multiply these numbers and the end divisions by that number. So take this, I'll plug this one in for the X, and then disconnect that. And then I'm going to duplicate this to do the same thing for the Y values. And the way I explain this is not the best at all, but basically this is going to make it to where now if we adjust the pixel density, we still see our image. If we adjust the pixel width and the height, we still see our image. If we take this off, it'd be perfectly fine. But now we will always have our image that we set out at first, which is pretty cool. Took me a minute to figure out what I was doing wrong there. But okay, so now we got everything set up for this. We got the bricks in place, so that way we have individual nodes. But what if we wanted to make these nodes into circles? We would do that with a Voronoi texture. And what the Voronoi texture does, basically, is it's just a whole bunch of random dots set as a value from 0 to 1. We're going to turn the randomness down, turn 2D on, so that way we don't have any 3D effects going on. Control T, add a texture and a mapping coordinate. Then what we're going to do is we're going to add a math node at less than. So what this is going to do is it's going to give us a bunch of circles, and you can see how this is going to become our mask for the other texture. So multiply this, or duplicate the multiplication, put this over here. Okay, as you can see, we have that circle mask already going on. We're going to just keep this on all the way, actually. So that way, we will always see the circles, technically. But if we turn this threshold up, you can see how the circles merge into the bricks pretty easily. So what we want to do is we want to have a 3x3 grid, similar to the way we had everything else set up. So we're going to turn the scale down to about 3, I guess. Yeah, 3 is probably it. Then go over 0.5, up 0.5. Seems like that worked. I'm going to turn this edge down on these so that way we can see. Seems like there's some clipping, but there's always going to be some clipping, sadly. especially if it's on 0.5, because these circles are touching each other. So if you want to put the 4.9, you're going to be cool. Or if you want to just turn this edge size to 0.01, that works as well. But it seems like it's working. So now that we have that, we want to be able to adjust the scale. Now the question is, which scale is going to work better for us? I think it's going to be that one. So let's take the group input, plug in pixel density. So now, okay, zoom in. We got all of our circles taken care of. Sweet. Okay. What if we want to change the width and the height now, though? Because those aren't going to go together. So what we need to be able to do is we need to be able to take the x and y values and multiply them by the width and the height. Okay. So where we messed up is this height is going to actually decrease as we turn this down. And the other height is going to increase. We don't want that. So go back over here. Seems like the width is fine though. The width is fine. But when we have the height go to, this is 1. When we have the height go to 0.5, let's say, the circles are half as, doubled their size. My bad. So instead of multiplying, let's divide by the height. That's not working either. Okay. Our problem is also with the pixels. So the pixels are doing their thing. That's what they're supposed to do. But we want the reverse of what's going on with this row height. So let's try and divide by 0.5. Or actually, no, we're going to switch it to 0.5 divided by that, because if you remember, this is 0.5 as the default value. So now we change the height, the edges come into play, gang gang. Now what if we change the height on here? We want it to go down, or change this to multiply. Okay, seems like it's going good. Okay. Seems like everything's going good. Set it to 10. And then if we wanted to set this to 5 and then 5, you can see that we still have just as many pixels as we would. But the difference is now the edges are coming into play a little bit more. And, you know, you don't really want to have a square value if you're using the width and the height. If you're trying to do something that's a little bit more stylized, they'll be your friend. But I like having the simple square LEDs and then just multiplying them up. That's the easiest way I've found. But okay, so we have... okay. So we got basically everything we need for this texture. And you could be done right here. You know, because you don't need anything else to just replicate a texture. And then we can plug in some values for this. I think it was like 60 or, I don't know, let's try 60. Seems like it works pretty well. And that's a pretty sick little texture. Now, in order, if you wanted to make this a little bit more unique or more true to the actual way things happen. If you wanted to make this a little bit more unique, or you wanted to kind of spice it up, make it a little bit more retro, what you'd do is you would add some scan lines. And so to do that, what we're going to do is we're going to take a wave texture. And originally I did this with a magic texture, and that was a lot more difficult to get to what I wanted it to do. But for this, we should be able to figure it out fairly easy. So this is the wave texture we have right here. And what we want it to do is we want it to scan across from top to bottom like this. Just go up and down. So it's basically already doing everything we want it to. If you want to take another multiply, switch these up so that way you can turn the scan lines off or on. Then boom, we got our scan lines going. If we change this, we can use the frame to adjust the offset. Offset! Hashtag frame, that gives us a driver. So now, as you can see, as the frames increase, the scan lines go up and down our thing. What we want to do is we want to take a math node, and we want to be able to adjust the speed of this. So at 1, it goes like this. At 5, we got more of a rapid. Then it's like at 20, you can't even comprehend how fast it's moving because of the way the things are going. And that's realistic. That's how real life is. Your naked eye can't capture how old CRT TVs have a scan line updating the pixels. But what we can do is we can try and replicate that, or we can make it a little bit more basic so that way, you know, you can see that effect a little bit better, but it's not as, you know, it's not as true. It's just what you want to do. We want to be able to change the scale too, so that way, you know, scale's at 0.5. These are a lot more similar to how real life was. We change it to 1. This is still pretty similar, but as we increase this, you know, we're just not going to be able to see that speed. The smaller the scale is, you'll actually be able to see those pixels get updated in real time. So, take a group input. We're going to plug it in to this value right here. We got to change this factor first. Change this factor to circle/square. And then this value is going to be scan speed. This value right here is going to be scan size. And this value right here is going to turn them on or off. Scans? Question mark. That at the top. Okay. And it's working. And if we tab out, we can start to adjust this. We want them on or off. We can take the speed, turn it up, so that way it looks like they're rolling in the other direction. But, or we can change the size. If we turn this to 0.1, it's kind of just like a seizure effect. But yeah, that's basically it. That's all we need to do for this. You can turn this into a node group right here, Control J. So that way we can move it out of the way. This is a node group right here, Control J. Move that out of the way. And so within a couple of multiplies and mixes, we have our image texture. Now you could be done with this right here. And I mean, I wouldn't blame you. But if you want to add something to it, you can get like a roughness map for some fingerprints or like some scratches. And so that way that'll kind of just break up the texture a little bit. So that's what I'm going to do. Open textures. I got this from CG, Ambient CG. So I'll link it in the description or whatever. It's a free texture, but it's just going to be a roughness map. And I'm going to add a color ramp to this, so that way we can adjust how strong the roughness map is. I'm also going to do that for the SCAD lines. Just so that way you have a little bit better control over what you're trying to do. So if we go back to scans, turn this back to 1. As you can see right here, we have like a fade going on where the pixels are getting attacked by the wave texture. We can increase this white value up here, and so that way the scans are a lot less dark, I guess. And then that way that will brighten up your other pixels. Or you can change this right here. And so that way it's kind of like a jittery effect. I don't really like it, but you know, whatever you want to do. And so take this roughness, let's plug it into the roughness. And now we plug this in right here. And this looks crazy. So okay, our image is still not being updated. There we go. Okay, so as you can see, we have a reflective screen where we want, and then we have some scratches popping up. They're not very high quality, you know. It's not anything. If you're going to want to do a close-up shot, I would get a displacement map. I don't really know how to do all that, though, by hand. So I'm going to leave this as it is. And, you know, you can make any updates to this as you wish. I'm going to have it a little bit more organized whenever I put it up. But, yeah, that's basically it. You can do this for any image texture you want. Just know that if you're starting the scale off with anything other than a square, it's gonna be a little bit different. You know, like when I'm doing the pixels 3x3, you might need a 4x3 or a whatever, you know. So you'll have to adjust these math nodes and everything to fit your specific purpose. That's why I said if you should probably start with a square, just so that way you can follow along with the tutorial. And then if you want to adjust the size, or say you wanted to make this a more of a like a bulged out screen effect, what you would do is you'd go in here, tab, subdivide, let's go 50. That's a lot of subdivisions. But then what you'll do is go over here, add subdivision surface, cool. And then we're also going to shade smooth. Then, so what you want to do after you subdivide and after you add a subsurface, you're going to just drag, and I'd say like everything but the very final vertices, and you're going to have proportional editing on GZ. Just bring it up ever so slightly. So that way, now you have the edges being bulged out. And you can do this with the middle too, to try and bring the middle out a little bit more. But as you can see, if you don't have this as set up as a circular plane, you're not going to be able to do that. I know there's a way, you know, I keep seeing shorts of there's a way to like inset a circle onto a square plane, but I don't know how to do that right now. I can't show you guys, sadly, but we can do this, which isn't everything, but you know, it's something. Bring this up a little bit more, so that way, boom. Now we got a little bit more of a screen effect, and then we can scale this by the X or the Y to match whatever dimensions you want to match. Then let's say I wanted to add in a different texture onto this. For that, let's just go with, I need something. Okay, but yes, sir. As you can see, it fits the original dimensions of the picture. Not to a T, because I didn't know what the actual dimensions are, but if you just scale the plane out to what your dimensions need to be after the fact and don't apply the scale, you'll be good. If we apply the scale, we're still good, I guess. Fuck it. I mean, shit. But, okay. And then let's try and update this to 1. We still got a 3x3. Let's turn the width, the height down. Yeah. There we go. So that way, now we have more uniform pixels. Yes, sir. All right. I hope y'all enjoyed.
All right, that's gonna wrap it up for the video. If you guys learned something or enjoyed the video, go ahead and leave a comment. If you stuck around for the whole thing, you're a trooper. I know it was kind of tough to get through, but I appreciate all the support. You know, if you got anything to say or anything to teach me, go ahead and leave it in the comments. But yeah, we're gonna go ahead and wrap it up for this one. Make sure to check out everybody else's videos in the description, and I'll catch you in the next one. Stay blessed.